Dear Heavenly Father, Father God, we just thank you for the days that we are in right now. We thank you for the judgments that we see coming upon the earth little by little, but seemingly faster and faster at all the time. Father, we thank you for these things because we know that this will result in many, many souls that otherwise would not have made it to make it into glory with the rest of us. And we just praise you for that, Father. We thank you for all the scriptures that are sprinkled throughout the text that just help us to understand that when your judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world will learn righteousness. Praise God. Isaiah 26, verse 9. And at midnight, we will rise to give thanks to you because of your righteous judgment. Psalm 119, verse 62. Father God, we thank you for choosing us before there was even time. Father, definitely before, as Psalm 139, verse 16 says, before that we were even born on this world, that you had established the works that we were to walk in, which is supported by Ephesians 2:10. And Father, we just thank you for choosing us for those works, for writing that into our books. We pray that we are anointed in whatever necessary fashion it is required. And even we pray, Father God, more so than just a regular anointing. We're asking you for a incredible anointing, and we have been asking for quite some time. We're going to continue to ask because that's what the Bible tells us to do, and we will continue to pray. And we are asking you, Father, in the name of Jesus and Lord, our King, our friend, our Lord Jesus, we are asking you to choose us. Many are called and few are chosen, and we are asking you, Father, to choose us. And if it requires us to make major changes in our walk, if it requires us to be aware of behaviors, attributes, things that are kind of embedded in our personalities or misunderstandings of the scripture, if we have unforgiveness in our heart, Father, raise that up before us. Help us not to trip up, Father God, in the days that we have ahead. And if there's any of us that are struggling, Father, in the name of Jesus, we pray. In fact, together we pray that stronghold will be broken. We hold up that stronghold in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, and we cast it into the pit by his blood. Hallelujah. We cast out all strongholds, all self-pity, all misery, all unhappiness. We cast it out into the pit. In the name of Jesus Christ, we declare the holy fire of God to shoot down from the heavens and to swirl around about us and blow white hot in the name of Jesus, scattering the darkness in every which direction, Father God, making a public spectacle of them thereof in the name of Jesus, in accordance with Colossians 2:15. We thank you, Father God, for strengthening us physically and spiritually in the days that we are in right now, that we are able to better serve you. Father, we praise you for helping us to have the necessary ingredients in our hearts and our minds to be able to overcome the feelings, the emotions that surge and overwhelm us at times when we see the devastation that is occurring to so many of our fellow brothers and sisters, the things that are happening to people in other countries, the evictions that are happening in astronomical numbers that are not making it into the news at all, and the quadrupling of the size of many of the homeless camps in different parts of the country, only to see many of them disappear. We know where they're being taken, Father. We see the enactment of essentially FEMA camps down in Australia. In particular, it appears to be Victoria, but it could be other parts of Australia as well. Father, we pray for our fellow brothers and sisters in Australia that you will give them the strength to be able to endure and also to be able to look at things through the eyes of Titus 1, verse 15, where it says, to the pure, all things are pure. Help us, Father God, to understand that when we are in some type of a lockdown, when we are in a situation that we should not become a part of by going out into the public and understanding that we are citizens of heaven and that our power is wielded by the word of God. Our power is wielded by the promises of Jesus Christ. Our power is wielded because we can bind and cast out demons into the pit. Our power is wielded because we can lay hands on the sick and they will recover. Our power comes from the throne on high, and we praise you for that, Father God, and we pray that you will help those of our brothers and sisters that are in different parts of the world right now, and possibly even our own areas of the world that may go on lockdown, and those who are in horrible lockdown situations that at the threatening of the beating of their bodies to be putting them in traction in the hospital by the very police that are supposed to serve them, Father, we just pray in Jesus' name that they will recognize those periods of lockdown, as an opportunity to spend special time in the secret place of the Most High. Help us all to understand that when the tide rises, when the darkness gets so horrible, when the roving bands of marauders and rapists and murderers are going through our cul-de-sacs, Father God, that the best place and the only place that we can be, the most powerful, powerful place in the entire universe, more powerful than any earthly weapon, is on our knees praying together, particularly as a family, if that has allowed us, Father God, if we have been so blessed. And we pray in the name of Jesus that we become the prayer warriors that you need us to be for the days that we have ahead of us. And that requires an anointing, a change of many of our hearts to understand that we truly do have the power to say, mountain, be thee cast into the sea in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ. Hallelujah. Help us to not just read the words, Father God, but to live the words like never before, because these days are growing darker and we can see it happening all around us. And we don't know when it's going to blow, Father. We don't know when the big red lever is going to be, but we know it's coming. And if it's a couple of months from now, if it's tomorrow, or if it's years from now, Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that the time that we have left, that you will help us with an innumerable company of angels in our lives, protecting our loved ones, protecting our dwelling places, protecting our jobs, ferreting out the demons of darkness, the attempts of the demons to come against us with indirect threat vectors in our lives. Father, we pray in the name of Jesus that you will assign a platoon of warrior angels, search and destroy mission, a Delta Force, SEAL Team 7 angels, Father God, to ferret out the attempts of the darkness to come against any one of us or our loved ones. In the meantime, as we draw in closer to you, Father God, and you reveal whatever it is that we need to understand about our walk, that we can make the course correction with your help. In the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, we pray and thank you. Lord Jesus, Father God, we praise you. Hallelujah. More than ever before. We need it now. We need that outpouring now. Give us the patience of Job to deal with the things that many of us are dealing with already. In Jesus' mighty name we pray. And now to him, the Lord Jesus Christ, who is able to keep us from stumbling and present us faultless someday before the presence of our Father God in the throne room with exceeding joy. And to you, Father, our Savior, who alone is wise, be glory, majesty, dominion, and power both now and forever. Hallelujah. Amen.
I told you to see what can pray. For I would come for you one day. I gave you my word so you would know the time I'd come and take you home. It's time for you to look up. The signs I gave for coming down. Don't be caught asleep and blind. You don't want to be left behind. Come and be home. 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 Come and be holy.
Praise God. A day is not a lifetime. If the mountain seems too big today, then climb a hill instead. If the morning brings you sadness, it might be okay to stay in bed. If the day ahead weighs heavy and your plans feel like a curse, there's no shame in rearranging. Don't make yourself feel worse. If the shower stings like needles and the bath feels like you're drowning. If you haven't washed your hair for days, don't throw away your crown. A day is not a lifetime. A rest is not defeat. Don't think of it as a failure. Just a quiet, kind retreat. It's okay to take a moment from an anxious, fractured mind. The world will not stop turning while you get yourself realigned. The mountain will still be there when you want to try again. You can climb it in your own time. Just love yourself until then. Remember that when King David was crying out to God after his, what most of us would consider to be a pretty colossal, it's almost hard to believe that he actually did it, and then had to have Nathan tell him. But I mean, he was crying out to their father, and really it was after so many verses. I don't even know. Let's see, Psalm 51. It goes all the way to 14, verse 14, where he asked the Lord to take his guilt away. We got to get to a place where we aren't allowing the devil to push us into a defeated position. Okay, praise God. We don't have time. We really have to be preparing ourselves. I don't want to speak out of line, but I will say this. I feel in my heart that, and I could be wrong. I know that. Okay, so I'm just saying. I'm putting out the disclaimer right now. But right at this moment in time, I am little by little coming to the conclusion that the key difference between the wise virgins and the foolish virgins, okay, there's a lot of people out there, a lot of believers out there that believe they're going to be part of the bride of Jesus Christ, and they're going to get raptured. And some of them, you know, if they do believe in the three watches, you know, the barley harvest, grape, you know, wheat harvest and grape harvest, if they believe that there are, three rescue missions, you know, or whatever the case is, but they believe they're going to make the rapture. They believe they're going to be part of the wise virgins, which they may be. I don't know. I'm just sharing an observation. But our Heavenly Father needs full gospel Christians. Okay, that means that if you don't believe in miracles, you don't believe that you can cast a mountain into the sea, if you don't have the faith of a mustard seed, if you don't understand that all this stuff doesn't have any power over you, if you don't believe it, guess what? Even if you're a Christian and you profess Jesus Lord and Savior, you don't get the benefit. I'm sorry, you don't. If you don't have faith, it doesn't come to you. Okay, all the scriptures are talking about these things will follow those who believe. Okay, you got to read the whole scripture. You got to read the buts. You got to read the ifs. You got to read the conditions. You got to understand that our Father expects something in return. You can't just go through, you know, and I'm not saying these people are going, this isn't about heaven and hell. Okay, what I'm talking about is whether or not you weather the storm with joy and praising God, you know, or shiver and you're horrifically scared until the point that you're killed. You know, there's a big difference. There's been thousands upon 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 thousands of hundreds of thousands of Christians over the last 2,000 years that have been killed, but may not have had to have been killed if they had, prayed a certain way or understood the power that they had in the name of the Lord Jesus. But if you don't understand that power, if you don't believe that you have that power, well, that's not good. All I can tell you is that the likelihood, scripturally speaking, the likelihood that the world will overcome you and stomp on you is very high. You have got to believe that you have the power. You've got to be full gospel. You can't cherry pick the scriptures. You can't cherry pick the events. You can't say, well, I've got all power in Jesus Christ to move mountains, but I got no power over a vaccine. If that's how you believe, you've got a very, very hard several, you know, whether it's months or years ahead of you, you're going to suffer. And I don't want anybody to suffer. I beseech you in the name of Jesus to read your Bible and to believe every single word that's in it. Oh, but I saw brother so-and-so and he died on a ventilator. Well, maybe brother so-and-so could have been Isaiah 57. Maybe God just wanted to bring him home. Isaiah 57 is very clear. In some certain circumstances, our Father said through the prophet Isaiah, the righteous perishes and no man takes it to heart, that merciful men are taken away while no one considers that the righteous is taken away from evil. So there are certain situations that our Heavenly Father is going to take some of our brothers and sisters home. And it might be through COVID. That doesn't matter. But you need to know these things. You need to know these scriptures exist. You should be memorizing these scriptures. You need to know that you have the power of the Godhead in you. You need to stand on that. You need to know that it's the demons of darkness that are controlling the people, the roving band of murderers. You need to know that you can point, you can lay hands on that vaccine and command it into saline and render anything that is inside of it of no poison. It is rendered into saline. I, in the name of Jesus Christ, I command this. But if you don't get it, what are you going to do when they're knocking on your door? What are you going to do when they're standing in your front yard? I have covered this on so many shows. I don't, and it's okay. It's okay. Praise God. Because you know what? There are some of us who just will not get it. They will not, well, they won't receive. Jesus constantly said throughout his scriptures, he said over and over again, if you can receive it, if you can receive it. Okay. Or sometimes the scripture would say, let the reader beware. All right. And then sometimes it's just flat right there out in the open for people to, they should be absorbing it as part of their walk in Christianity, but they're not. I don't know why. I mean, maybe they just don't have, if they haven't seen a miracle in their life, maybe they just don't really believe in them. Maybe they're a type of a quasi-cessationist in the sense, cessationists scare me a little bit because I don't want anybody to go to hell. I don't want anybody to go to hell. Period. End of story. Don't want it. Pray all the time for millions and millions and millions of people all over the world, the lost constantly. I do not want anybody ever, ever. I don't even want to think of it. Okay. Praise God. And I think that ultimately ought to be how we all feel. Thank you, Jesus. All right. But here's the thing. What is a cessationist? A cessationist is somebody who believes that the power of the Holy Spirit, the power in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, the power of miracles, the power of speaking in tongues is no longer with us today. Bunk! That is bunk! It is a lie from the devil. And what really scares me is that the cessationists, which are, by the way, a lot, oh my goodness gracious sakes alive. I would like, as a matter of fact, I'm going to type this. I don't think I'm going to be able to get a number on this. I don't. But I'm going to type it into a search engine here. How many cessationists are there? Oh, wow. Somebody else had searched it up. Cessationism versus continuing. Okay, so let's see what it says. Let's see if it gives me a number. Oh, it has a whole big thing written about it. I don't know if it has any numbers. I just want numbers. I just want a number. Cessationism, it gives a bunch of history. Types of continuing, blah, 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 history. Nope, it's not giving me a number. I don't think they know the number. I don't think they actually know the number. Now, it may be out there. There may be somebody that took a poke at it at some point, and it's out on the internet, and I'm just not seeing it, praise God, but that's okay. All right, hallelujah, thank you, Jesus. But there's a lot of them. A cessationist believes that when the scripture says, until that which is perfect comes, tongues will continue, prophecies will continue until that which is perfect, and they believe that which is perfect is the Bible. Which anybody who knows anything about the Bible and the Bible translations knows that's about as far from the truth as high as the heavens are above the earth, because mankind is who did the translations. That's to suggest that the people who did the actual translations from the Greek and never mind, that's a whole nother problem. But they actually try to hold that up and say, well, the Bible came and the Bible's perfect, therefore there is no more speaking in tongues, there is no more power, there are no more miracles. The people that speak in tongues today, because I didn't receive tongues, must be getting it from the devil because I didn't get it. That's what it is pride, and it's a scary, scary thing, because that's, when I consider all of the behaviors of a human being on the earth today, which are quadrillions, I don't even know how many are, I have no idea. We'll just say bunches and bunches and bunches of different behaviors that humans have. When I consider all of them and I try to say to myself, what would be the definition of blasphemy of the Holy Spirit? Well, that would be, if you're blaspheming God, you're basically suggesting that he's not God, right? I mean, pretty much, right? I mean, I'm sure there's other variations to the, you know, who knows to the nth power. But the point I'm making is, if you're out there publicly preaching and teaching and believing with all your heart that the power of the Holy Spirit doesn't exist anymore, then are you blaspheming the Holy Spirit? Are you? I don't know the answer to that, but that that gives me the heebie-jeebies. All right, that scares me. I don't even want to think about it. All right, now let's ask ourselves another question in alignment with that question. What about our fellow brothers and sisters who do not believe that they have the power that we were told that we have in the Bible? That power comes from the Holy Spirit. That power comes from the gifts in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. That ought to put the fear of God in these Christians out there that are running and bouncing off the walls, having no idea that they have power over these things. If we can't exhibit power over these things right now, what are we going to do when things get 10,000 times worse? And they are. They're going to get way worse. Way, way worse. The stuff that we're going through right now is nothing. Nothing by comparison to what we're going to go through. So if we don't learn to come against it in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ and cast it into the pit, then we're going to be in a lot of trouble. A lot of trouble. And it's going to run over us. It's going to run over us. And I don't want that to happen to anybody. And I beseech anyone in the listening audience, and I will continue to do this until God stops my heart. Hallelujah. And that is, seek the baptism of the Holy Spirit with all your heart. Seek the Father with all your heart, your mind, your soul. Go out and find Daniel Sweet's DVD. You're going to have to do some hunting, I promise you that. But I don't even know if it's still out there. But hunt. Maybe even look on eBay. But it's called, his name is Daniel Sweet, Pastor Daniel Sweet, S-W-E-E-T. And How to Speak in Tongues is the title. How to Speak in Tongues. All right. And also there's other ones out there. There's other DVDs you can get that you can participate in them. Even if you don't particularly care for the pastor or whatever, you can still get hunt. Be hungry, search for it, and seek the baptism of the Holy Spirit with all of your heart. And believe me, and a lot of people do have it already, but they don't speak in tongues. And then they heard some Pentecostal out there going, well, if you don't speak in tongues, then you don't have the evidence of the, baptism of the Holy Spirit. And I'm like, I'm sorry, dude, but you totally don't know what you're talking about. You're not reading your Bible properly. Just like about 99.99999% of all the people out there that call themselves Christians. So how close is it to blasphemy of the Holy Spirit when somebody's out there running around, bouncing off the walls, and they believe we've got to run for your lives, run for your lives. There's no power in the name of Jesus. That is scary. That is very, very scary land. That is a very scary realm to be walking in. Being in a place where you're denying the power. Wow. That is really scary. Now, I'm not saying to go line up and say, me, give me my fourth shot, please, thank you. I don't have enough hydras floating around inside of me. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the people that are in places where they don't have a choice. And it's getting worse. It's getting a lot worse. We're going to talk about that tonight. We're going to talk about the all this weirdness going on, and then we're going to bring on Sister. I don't know how to pronounce her name, but I think it's Trupti or Trupti. It might be Trupti. I don't know if it's a long U or a short U sound. Desai. I might say Miss Desai or Miss. Then I'll get it wrong, and she'll be married and it'll be Mrs. Anyway, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. But anyway, So please do consider with all of your heart seeking the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Okay, it's not that you have to have it, but it is, boy, let me tell you something, you're going to want it in the days to come. You really, and anybody who loves the Lord their God with all their heart, their mind, and their soul, and is obedient to the first commandment, that doesn't understand the power that they have in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ to command, it's mind-shattering to me. I am starting to little by little come to the conclusion, although I may be wrong, that the difference between the wise and foolish virgins are those who know they have the power in the name of Jesus versus those who don't. All I can say is, when I look at the scriptures and I look at the progression of the end times events that occur, and until he that restrains is taken out of the way, which we know is God's power, heaven's resources, heaven's angels, and the prayers of the saints and all that, and if you don't even understand the power that you have in Jesus, I mean, that's pretty serious. That's mind-blowing, and I can't believe what I'm seeing. And even in this country doesn't have an excuse. But unfortunately, it is the way it is. I'm not going to pick apart all the different denominations and things like that, but I can sure list a whole bunch of them. And I know a lot of people that are in what, you know, the Pentecostals and Assembly of God consider to be, they call them dead churches because there isn't speaking in tongues and there isn't miracles and there, people aren't laying hands on each other. They're not casting out demons. They're not doing anything that Mark 16, 16, 17, and 18 says. These signs will follow those who believe. Well, they're not doing it. They're just not doing it. And so those who are in Holy Spirit-filled churches refer to the other churches as dead churches. They don't mean it in a mean way. It's just that they don't have the Holy Spirit. The activities, the manifestation of the miracles of God and all that kind of stuff that we're supposed to have because the Bible says that we're supposed to have it. And so everybody's running to and fro. Oh, my gosh, we got to run for our lives. Don't do this. Don't do that. Starve your children to death. Force them to eat maggot-filled sandwiches and get beaten by the police if you live in Victoria, Australia, because heaven forbid you should do anything or use the name of Jesus as your power that you were given by God. But no, everybody wants to go, oh, no, run for your life. Run for your life.
Folks, if we're running for our lives right now, what are you going to do when the nuclear bombs go off? What are you going to do? What are you going to do when there's a cloud of nuclear radioactive fallout moving over your neighborhood and you have no good water to drink? You're going to die? Just going to lay down and die and go, yeah, guess it's my time. I'm not. No way. I'm going to stand by the power of the name of the Lord Jesus Christ against everything. I don't care what it is that these entities think they're going to lift against me, any weapon, earthly or spiritual. Why don't we practice the word of God? I don't get it. Praise God. And that's going to be the deal breaker. That is, I believe that with all of my heart. I believe that our Heavenly Father and our Lord Jesus Christ are going to be looking for those of us who are willing to stand in the midst of that meteor shower, in the midst of all the, you know, chemical warfare, you know, smallpox, you know, Ebola nonsense, and we're going to come step right out into it in the name of Jesus, just like David Hogan did. If you haven't seen the David Hogan testimony, which is, you know, like broken in most of the YouTube channels that still have it out there, break it into like nine different, some of them break it into nine, some of them break it into five. He was in a Pentecostal church many years ago, and it was called, and the title of it that they gave it is Faith to Raise the Dead. Faith to Raise the Dead. We all need to become David Hogan's. Okay, if you haven't watched David Hogan's video series, Faith to Raise the Dead, David Hogan, if you have not watched that entire episode from beginning to the very, very end with a notepad in your hand, because that's who we have to become. If we're not like David Hogan now, it's going to be too late by the time you're going to need that power. You're going to be too busy running around like a chicken with your head cut off because you don't understand the power that you already have. David Hogan was so pumped. You got to understand. And it's not just David Hogan. There are people that he has called down there. I wrote him a letter. He asked me to come down and join him in Mexico. The things that have happened down there, the way that God – now, I couldn't. I wasn't able to, and I sat there and I cried because – I felt so guilty to be so stuck. But anyway, you know, David Hogan walked into one of the hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of villages full of unbelievers and Mexican, you know, I don't know what you call them, indigenous tribes people. And they lived in these different, and they live all over these jungles in different parts of Mexico. And he would go and hunt them down in jeeps and things and with his team of missionaries, which, by the way, a lot of them he recruited from the United States. He brought them down. He said, come on down and join us just like he did me. And let me tell you something, you know, one of the hundreds of testimonies that he gives in Faith to Raise the Dead, he talks about, he goes into a village. Now, he did it all the time. That was what they did all the time. And you know, you got to hear the whole story, because if you don't hear the whole testimony, you are underarmed. Oh, yeah. Yep. You don't know. It's the best I can think of to point you to that is still available out on the internetosphere to help you to understand who we have to become on very short notice. Or you can choose not to go there and hope, believe. I certainly wouldn't want to be one of those people.
But anyway, David Hogan goes into this. This is just one of probably, like I said, 100 or more testimonies in the five-day visit that he did at the church in Pensacola. And, you know, and again, this is like 25 years ago that he did it, I think, or more maybe. And he went into this village, and the people were coming out of the huts. You know, they live in huts, of course. It's very Amazonian or Amazon rainforest-ish like kind of stuff. And you know, and he goes in, and they come out. They knew him. They heard about him, and they called him in. And they're like, you know, Brother Hogan, Brother Hogan. You know, some of them could speak English. A lot of them couldn't. And took him in to this one hut. And over in the corner was, I guess, you know, the way he put it was he couldn't really tell. It sort of looked like a person. He wasn't really sure. You know, there was like, you know, coverings all over the person's body. The person was laying on their back or whatever. Looked like they, you know, like they were dead or something, according, you know, as best I can remember. And he went over, and the person, what, their entire body was completely wiped out by leprosy. And I don't know if you know this or not, but leprosy basically, when it went over, you know, given enough time, it will turn your entire body and your internal organs into mush. Literally turn them into gooey, snot-like mush. Okay, so kids, you guys got to, you know, watch out and don't be like paying, you know, put your hands over your ears. I know, it's kind of creepy. But anyway, he went right over, and this guy was like, you know, if there's like an end stage of leprosy, this dude was like on Y stage. Okay. I mean, it was bad. And he even said when he walked in the room, it was just the smell of death. It was decaying flesh. It was horrible. It was a horrible, horrible, horrible smell. And he walked over there, and you know, David is not an unintelligent individual. The guy is fabulously intelligent. And so he knew what he was dealing with. He knew this person was toast. He knew this person was dead. He knew this person's, you know, internal organs had turned into goo. Okay. And you know what he did? He raised up his hand, and he took this hand, and he shoved it right into the center of the goo of this person's decaying body. And he said, in the mighty name of the Lord Jesus Christ, I command this body to be healed. Know what happened? Nothing. Nothing happened. He got up, wiped off his hands, said, praise the Lord, thank you, Jesus, gave people hugs, and went out and preached the gospel and had a big gathering, and then ultimately went and left. I don't know how many years passed by. I'd have to go back and listen to the testimony again, see if he even mentions it. But quite some time, I think a matter of possibly years, but definitely a good amount of time went by before he had passed by that village a second time. And when he and his small group, they would drive around in these, you know, Jeeps and things, and through treacherous territory, sort of like the kind of territory that Sammy Mwangi goes through when he goes to Idri Island there by on the corner of Rwanda and the DRC in Africa. But anyway, listen, so check it out. So I think years later, many long, long time later, David Hogan goes back into that same village again. And they pull up, you know, their Jeeps pull up, and all the villagers are happy to see them. And this guy comes running up to David, and he's like, Brother Hogan, Brother Hogan, I'm so happy that you are here. I'm so happy that you're here, Brother Hogan. And David looked at him, and he goes, do I know you, brother? Do I know who you are? Because he didn't recognize him. And he goes, Brother Hogan, I am the man who you prayed for. I am the man whose whole body was eaten up by, completely wiped out by leprosy. I am the man who you took your hand and put inside of me. I am all healed. I am healed from head to toe. Guy's completely healed. David Hogan didn't get up and go, ah, doggone it. It looks like the power of Jesus left me. That poor guy, he's dead for sure. That's the kind of Christians that we got in the United States of Babylon the Great. If you don't get handed a hamburger right away, pickles and lettuce, don't upset us, blah, 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 out the window, you're like kind of like, well, I guess I don't have any authority in the name of Jesus. Didn't happen right away. Never mind it. Jesus said, blessed is he who believes and has not seen. I want that blessing. I'm going to get it too. Thank you, Jesus. All right, hallelujah. Also, I wanted to go ahead and read this to you. Kids, are you ready? This is okay. All right. So I misunderstood an email that one of the folks that I talk to a lot of helps out with the news, Sister Vera, sent me. I misunderstood. She was talking about something different, but she passed over new legalese and stuff from a YouTube. Everybody's changing all their contracts. The problem is it's backfiring on everybody. So you think you're clicking on a new privacy thing. What you're really doing is you're telling them it's okay for them to do whatever they want to with your information. So all these privacy freaks out there that are telling everybody, sign these new privacy agreements. Well, you know what? Human beings are going to do what human beings always do. They're busy. I do it myself. And I go in there and I say, oh, man, I don't have time to read 30 pages of this stuff. So I just say, like, I got to get some work done. So I click the click wrap agreement. We all do. Okay, and guess what? They know that. They're taking advantage of it. Anyway, it's a side point. But anyway, so I responded back to Sister Vera, you know, because she said she basically said, you know, they think that they have us all trapped. Now, what she was really referring to is that the devil, you know, Satan's got them trapped instead. Now, I didn't realize that at the time, and I just responded back. I said, look, I said, gosh, I really hate to be the negative naysayer all the time, but the reality is that the Lord has allowed the forces of darkness to trap us. All these unbelievably awful things that are happening worldwide, which I discuss on every show, are being allowed by our Heavenly Father God. Reference chapter 1, reference Ecclesiastes 7:14, reference bunches of other scriptures all over the Bible. I go on to say, if God does not allow them to fully trap all the people of the world in a new control grid from the bowels of Sheol, then how can we expect the things that Jesus said would happen to come true? What about the book of Revelation and World War III and the United States countrywide real civil war that we are expecting to outbreak at any time, and the nukes and the Christians being taken and thrown into jail and the FEMA camps and all these things that Jesus warned us about? Now, Jesus didn't use the term FEMA camp, but he did talk about us being brought before magistrates and our kids and our families turning us in and all that kind of stuff. You think that we're exempt? No, we're not exempt. It's just building up slower here. All right, and it goes on to say, yeah, I said, they do have us cornered. Amen. And it's going to get so much more worse that even the best of us are going to get scared, which will put a good number of us on our knees before God most of the day, every single day. The population of the world is currently trapped in a death grip, and the next 8 to 12 months will be the final determination if our Father is going to keep it going or give us a teensy little break with Trump in 2024. And I, by the way, I could give a – I don't care if it's Gomer Pyle. I am a citizen of heaven. I could care less. If our Father wants, you know, 50 large, you know, extinction level event meteors to smash into the earth tomorrow morning, I'm perfectly fine with it. Praise God. All right. But I just happen to be stuck here and, you know, and don't, you know, I could, whatever, you know. So anyway, the point is we all must be citizens of heaven. Otherwise, you're still stuck. You're stuck someplace where you shouldn't ought to be stuck. And you darn sure don't want to be making Trump your Lord and Savior, which is what a lot of people do. Save me, Donald Trump. But the point is, we, as true citizens of heaven, in accordance with the scripture and our guidance in the scripture, should be wanting to be able to serve God as unhindered as possible. All right? Amen? But at the same time, we shouldn't also think that we're going to, like, oh, God is going to let me pray away the book of Revelation. God is going to let me pray away the Olivet Discourse. No, he's not. We got to go through these things in order for the glory to come and for us to be risen up in that glory. And do you think you're going to be able to, what are you going to do if you can't stand against this vaccine right now in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ? What good are you for the kingdom of God? What good are you when there are people with their arms missing, with their legs blown off, with bleeding to death in the streets, children, you know, that need to be saved and brought back to life? What are you going to do if you can't pray, if you don't believe that you have the power in Jesus now? What are you going to do when God really needs you? What are you going to do? All right.
Praise God. We have got to get on our game, and we got to start working on that as soon as we possibly can. And I went on to say in this little email, I said, the population of the Earth, of the world, is currently trapped in a death grip. And the next 8 to 12 months will be the final determination if our Father is going to keep it going or give us a one teensy little break with Donald Trump in 2024. If Trump 2024 happens, the end game will not be pretty. We are trapped like rats in a cage, right where our Father God wants us, in the secret place of the Most High. Glory be to God.
Every knee will bow, every tongue will confess, you are Lord. Every knee
Majesty, greater than any kingdom that has ever ruled this earth.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. And if you feel led in this troubled world that we're in right now, a lot of our brothers and sisters are going through kind of a version of hell on earth right now. And the singer of that song, him and his wife, she was also in the song. His name is Kirk Martin. He's been a guest on this radio show several times. He has his own podcast called His Glory Alone Radio. Again, His Glory Alone Radio. If you type those four words into Google or whatever, you will see a link that says whobazoo.com, and that's the link you want to click on, His Glory Alone Radio. And the reason why I say the whobazoo link is that is a service kind of like YouTube, but it's, you know, Christianly, where he puts his podcast, and you can help him out. I mean, if you want, if you feel led, he's going through some double surgeries, unable to work, family of multiple boys, autistic son, really, really difficult time. So if you feel led to give, just like it says in the book of Acts chapter 3, praise God for you. And I'm not going to say anything more than that. Do your own reading, read your own Bible, understand how the kingdom works, and you will understand the blessings that you will receive. And I'll just leave it at that. Don't be a good Berean, Acts 17:11, and search the scripture daily to see if it is so. All right, kids, are you ready to go? I want to see some happy kids. This is the time of year for you guys to be happy. All right, kids. Kids, why did the man put his money in the freezer? Why did the man put his money in the freezer? Because he wanted cold hard cash. Right, kids? Cold hard cash? Yeah. Once they take out all the ATM machines and everything, everybody's going to wish they had cold hard cash. And like all these people are that, it just blows me away. People are like buying silver and gold, even though the Bible says we'll be throwing it in the street. And I'm like, you know, I want to see, no, I don't want to see it. I want to. You know, can you imagine what's going to happen when people are starving to death and they're standing in line for the last couple of loaves of bread and somebody whips out a gold coin? That's like saying, kill me now. Anybody that has a gun, tire iron, just beat me to death right now and take my gold. How does that work? Common sense is completely, you know, drained out. I don't know if it's the fluoride in our toothpaste or what the deal is, but, you know, something has drained common sense out of the brains of pretty much anybody who lives in the United States of Babylon the Great. All right, kids, what did one toilet say to the other? What did one toilet say to the other? You look flushed, which I think is a good thing, right, kids? You know. I would prefer it to be that way myself. Thank you, Jesus. All right, next one, kids. Why did Johnny throw, not me, somebody else named Johnny, why did Johnny throw the clock out of the window? Why did Johnny throw the clock out of the window? Because he wanted to see time fly. You know, time fly, clock through the window. You get it, kids. Come on. Work with me. Come on. Oh. I thought I missed on that third one, but it was just too good. Listen, I got to play this for you. Now, I will make mention because it comes first in the show notes, but who cares? Not who cares about the earthquake. I'm just saying, who cares what order I say it in? All right, 7.5 earthquake hits Peru. They're still trying to do the damage assessment. It looks like it might have caused a lot more damage than was originally thought. So we're going to have to wait for a couple of days to find out exactly how bad the damage was and how, you know, and that kind of thing. All right, praise God. Now, what I'm going to read to you, what I'm going to play for you here is a teeny-weeny little snippet. The Independent, which is a UK magazine, you know, media outlet, they're publicizing this worldwide, but they're doing it because they want to defame them. They're doing it because they want to make them look like a bunch of horses patooties. Okay, that's why they're doing it. They're trying to defame them and make them look like, you know, rebels. Okay, but it's not the case. All right, and the title of the headline from The Independent is General Michael Flynn says COVID was created by global elites who are already plotting their next virus.
Now, anybody listening to this show that doesn't know that's for real isn't paying attention for sure. All right, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. But I have queued up another snippet from that, and I want you to hear it, okay, because I listen to the whole thing, and I rarely ever do that, but this is important. It starts at the 33-minute and 22-second mark. I want you to hear. Now, think about this. I'm going to set you the stage, and then we're going to bleed over a little bit past the 8 o'clock hour, but I've already let Sister Trupti know that we might bleed over a little bit, and that's okay. She has, you know, the whole, you know, until, gosh, it's 8:30 Central Time. She's calling in from Central. Praise God. But anyway, okay, we're going to move quickly, but there's a lot of stuff to get out. I got to get out. All right, so anyway, listen to this. All right, I've got it queued up, and I want you to hear what they're talking about. Now, remember this. Is already aware. Look, they're playing. We may not care. You know, maybe you don't even vote. Maybe you believe that the left and the right are one and the same and it's all control grid and we're just watching it all being choreographed by the devil. At the end of the day, it doesn't really matter. It's still material to the outcome of events that are going to trigger the biblical end times timeline and jettison us into Revelation chapter 6 at light speed. Okay, where you know, there's a global financial collapse, and then the next thing you know, we're in World War III, just like that. Bam, 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 bam. All right, and that it's going to be some bad stuff. There's going to be nuclear bombs going off. It's going to be bad stuff. And that ain't even the destruction of Babylon the Great. That's just that ground-based nukes are the ones that I'm talking about. The ground-based nukes are going to take out about half a dozen cities, probably about seven, maybe more. Seattle, Chicago, San Francisco. I know it's Dallas and Houston, Atlanta, Washington. D.C. is one of them. Not sure. I got to go back and look at my list. I have it tucked away. But anyway, listen to this. Consider this. The forces of darkness, without naming any names, because there are way too many to name, the ones that we know about are the tip of the iceberg, and they're not all that powerful. The ones that we don't know about are the ones that are really powerful, and I don't even want to get into that sickness. But anyway, here's the thing. They know what they're up against. They already see their power in the legislative, executive, and blah, blah, blah branches waning. They see it all the things that Obama has done to destroy this country, the millions upon millions upon millions, maybe billions of dollars that have been spent worldwide, the Wuhan attack from Fort Detrick of a bioweapon across the entire world, all these things, the control grid, you name it, pick it. The FEMA camps, the beatings, the riots, all the stuff. It's going to go away. They're going to lose it all. Midterm elections. And they know it. Now listen to what this group of folks are talking about. It says, Alex Jones hosts a powerful discussion with General Flynn, his brother Joe Flynn, and Patrick Byrne, who's a well-known global media kind of a guy, over the deep state's plot to implode the United States. All right. Now, I queued it up at a very critical point in the discussion. Ready, get set, go.
Totally agree. What about the big question from you asked me to ask about who's got to run for president? He's handed the microphone. Why don't we do that?
But. Well, I can tell you that I know elements in the Republican Party who are already talking about if Trump doesn't run, it's a draft Flynn movement. There's a draft Flynn movement latent in the Republican Party, just waiting for Donald Trump to make his decision. And I think that we could not find a better president.
I'm not even gonna...
a bigger bullet on my forehead. Okay, there's already one on my back.
I'm not going to say anything because I'm still his little brother. And he can smack me upside my head while I'm sitting next to him.
My dream job is going to be to go work for Mike Flynn and his brother, the chief of staff.
No, I think that the next 18 months is going to be crucial to this country. And I think that your audience, which is a great audience, and others out there, realize what's happened. And I think the people of the state of Virginia, we saw it in the state of Virginia. We saw it in New Jersey. We saw it in these local elections. They have overplayed their hand. The question is, can we take it back from them before they do something very drastic, very authoritarian, or some type of black swan event that is created in order for an authoritarian move to take place? That's what my big concern is. Probably, you talk about this kind of stuff a lot.
All right. So there you have it, a black swan event. You can look it up. You can look it up. It's documented, easy to find, study about it. But what he's talking about is an event that was – they're running out of time, and they know it.
who decides whether or not they can do a black swan event and continue to topple the country and wipe out the midterm elections? I don't know if you're aware of this or not, but the United Nations, and we're going to talk about this in a second. Like I said, I let Sister Desai know that we'll probably run a little bit over the 8 o'clock hour, and that's fine. But anyway, who decides? What is that black swan event? Is it going to be the release of chemical warfare agents? You know, Sister Nancy pointed out to me that in the Ceremony Vision, she mentioned that, you know, that a lot of the things that she talked about, like the chemical agents being dropped in several cities, causing people to die within 24 hours, the hemorrhagic fever attack, you know, that who knows what it is, maybe some new version of Marburg or Ebola, but people are dying in 24 hours. So it's none of this, you know, 18-20-day thing, okay? Really bad stuff. You think people are afraid now? You know, the only thing they need to be afraid of is a respirator pretty much, okay? So, you know, or some kind of a, you know, freak situation where they just die, which we know what's going on pretty much. But anyway, so praise God. Thank you, Jesus, for helping us to understand these things. But what about the Black Swan event? What could it be? I don't know, but it makes sense. I know that if I was a sick, twisted entity waiting for Satan to incarnate into my body and become the Antichrist like Obama, that I would have that planned already. Okay? I would work as fast as I could against the script that was written. I would have all of my puzzle pieces where they needed to be. My game of Risk would be fully loaded. I would be ready to move, and I would have a move, a counter move, and a counter move. I would have a plan A, plan B, plan C. They would all be queued up, and I would be ready to go because they can see it. They can see the tidal wave of red coming at them. And you know what? They can try to fraud their way around it, but I don't think they can do that. I don't think they can. They've controlled elections now for 75, 80 years. And you know what? And now they're realizing they're up against a tidal wave of Republican voters and Democrats that have flipped over to the other side because they're not going to let them control their children and teaching them to do sick, twisted, abominable things at young ages. And the parents are over it. And then that breaks down the wall between left and right in this country. At that point, forget about it. It's game over. And they know it. They know that they went too far. That's what General Flynn's brother, Joe, was saying. They've played their hand. They're out of gas. They can't. There's nothing left for them to do. They can continue to go after the January 6th fake rioters. Okay, they can continue to do all that kind of stuff. But you know what? It hasn't borne any fruit. They're stuck. Now, don't get me wrong. They're enacting all kinds of horrible laws, and they're continuing to move forward against the people of the United States of Babylon the Great as fast as they possibly can and the rest of the countries of the world. So everything is in full force. It's moving as fast as they can possibly move. But really, at this rate of speed, with only 18 months left, you know, they're going to have to pull something out of their hat, something big. Could be. We'll have to wait and see. But who? What's the question? What's the answer? Who controls whether or not Obama is able to pull off a black swan event? Our Father. Our Heavenly Father. That's why I said in that email earlier, I said in the next 18 months or so, it will make the final determination of whether or not our Father has induced labor or not. If our Father induced labor and said, okay, that does it, the judgment is now coming, and he pulls his hand of protection off the earth, which obviously he did long enough for the, you know, this plandemic bioweapon attack against mankind. So what is it in us that would make us see that our Father would change his mind, you know, and not, we don't know. We don't know. Maybe the Lord knows that more people will be saved. More people will be awakened. More people will make it into heaven, because that will definitely drive our Father to stop with angels and heaven's resources, heaven's power. He will stop the black swan event. I think they're going to try it no matter what.
whatever that is. I don't know. All right. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. So I wanted to play that for you because it's exceedingly important. But anyway, on that note, to keep the show moving forward as fast as I possibly can, let's go ahead and do the rest of the news. That'll probably take me less than about 8 minutes. And then we'll bring on Sister Trupti Desai. I hope I'm saying her name properly. Praise God. And if I'm not, I'm sorry. All right. Anyway, on that note, let's go full steam ahead into the news. Praise Jesus. Here we are.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I have your attention, please?
It's not normal.
It's just wrong.
What? It's not normal.
This is disturbing.
Game over.
All right, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. First up, January 6th panel subpoenas Roger Stone and Alex Jones over the participation in the Stop the Steal rally. And they had a lot of conversation in that band.video that I just played for you a little bit of. They had a lot of conversation about all that. But anyway, we know what's going on. Anyway, praise God. Let's just go ahead and keep on moving forward. Praise Jesus. Next up. All right, emergency Sunday broadcast. The United Nations is now preparing to declare worldwide martial law and suspend global elections. Now, that is a pretty ominous headline. I get it, but I don't think it will work in this country. The states, anybody, anyway, so again, 50 independent states that have their own judicial, executive, and, it's there's no way. And that's why that's why this country is going to go into civil war again. They're going to be pushed into it. And then I think they're on their verge of it now already. Anyways, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Next one up. The Epoch Times reports, Florida reports the lowest daily COVID-19 cases per capita in the United States of America. Well, we'll see how long that lasts. All right, praise God. Next up, Bakersfield.com reports, we are scared every day. Student flights and assaults on teachers trouble Florida schools amidst the pandemic. 14 Coral Springs High School, a video went viral on social media, showed a male student beating up another female student as staff members tried to intervene. And I could just go through the list. Monarch High School, Palm Beach County, Broward County. And by the way, if you think it's just Florida, it's not. The world – here's what – the world, not us, the world, the fleshy world, needs to be afraid of. What they're not telling us. Okay? What you're not hearing on this radio show. I'm going to tell you what I believe, and I'm pretty sure I'm right, or else I wouldn't say it. But I believe the situation is horrifically worse than we are aware. They don't talk about things like all the people that are getting evicted from their homes. They never mention it. And that's just one of probably 50 horrible things that, you know, there's this, like, okay, so like, just give you an example. So I go, I had a wrestling match with one of my puppy dogs because I was trimming his nails and, you know, whatever, you know what happened. Anyway, so long story short, I went to buy this special stuff to help me out the next time I got to trim his nails. And I was at Walmart.com and I forgot that I had already filled up my grocery cart for a whole bunch of stuff that I wanted to buy. But sometimes I just leave my grocery cart full. Now, why am I telling you this? Well, because, you know, 5 or 6 days have gone by and I went back to buy this stuff to help me with my puppy dogs. And there was my full cart. And in my cart, it said, 7 items in your cart are no longer available. Now, this isn't weird stuff. This is chicken, you know, chicken. It's drumsticks, you know, hamburger, the 80%. Because, you know, if you're on keto, you want the fatty stuff. I'm just telling you, folks. I had probably 10 things in my cart and 7 of them are gone. They have no more stock on them. That is a first for me. I have never seen that. Not once. Not once. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Next one up. Headlines read several days ago, or, you know, about 48 hours ago, give or take, worst ever COVID variant, what we know so far. So right away, all the mainstream media and blah, 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 blah is out there telling everybody day one, oh, this is the worst we've ever seen. It's horrible. The Omicron from South Africa. We're in trouble. Run for your lives. Except they were wrong. But it's too late because somebody called, they all called fire in the theater. So all across Europe, they shut down all the air travel. The United States shut down air travel. In several countries, everybody's already starting to freak out. The Omicron, oh my gosh, everybody's going to die. The hospital is going to overflow. We've got to put masks on in our own homes. If we go to the restroom and we're by ourselves in our house, we still got to wear a mask. They're doing it again. But here's the thing. Let's keep on reading the headlines. Red list update. 6 countries added as experts say the new COVID variant is, quote, the worst we have seen so far. Really? Really? Let's continue to read, shall we? Another headline from the Epic Times. Omicron COVID-19 variant found in more countries, sparking global concern. The Dutch, the Danish, and many other European countries are confirming that the cases have spread to Europe, and there are confirmations that it has spread to many other places worldwide. And everybody's freaking out. Listen to this. The Dow Jones plunges 1,000 points, the worst drop of 2021, as the new COVID-19 variant triggers a market sell-off. Oh, no, it's the Omicron. Oh, but yet there's more. The Epic Times reports Goldman Sachs slams the Omicron panic. The mutation is unlikely to be more than malicious. So Goldman Sachs, why are they saying that? Because Goldman Sachs stock is going into the toilet right now. And they're trying to tell everybody, keep your stock, don't sell it. This is going to turn out to be a big bunch of nothing. Well, guess what? It is. Okay, next headline says, praise God, thank you, Jesus. Omicron variant causes unusual but mild symptoms, they say now. South African Medical Association heads publicly announces to the world, mild symptoms. But then, oh no, look out for that entity that calls itself Fauci from Operation Paperclip. Reuters reports United States readies fight against Omicron, but too soon for lockdowns, according to the entity that refers to itself as Fauci. Now, that's what you call pandering. All right. Anyway, praise God. Look it up. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Got to keep on going. Next one up. COVID variant as deadly as Ebola may emerge. Top physician warns. Further mutations of the COVID-19 variant virus could spawn a strain as contagious as Delta and as deadly as the Ebola virus. Warning of the World Medical Association. Oh, no. Nah. They've got bioweapons queued up. We just a couple of days ago, they found the smallpox in the lab inside of downtown Philadelphia. Come on. It was within 20. It was within 48 hours of Bill, whatever he is, Gates, you know, waving his hands in the air like he does, looking around, telling his lies, going, well, you know, we got to prepare ourselves for a terrorist attack, you know, because, you know, like smallpox or something like that. And then I'm sure he's like sitting there going, whoopsie daisy, they just caught us. The question is whether or not they go through with it. Once they're caught, as Robert Vandreas Mitchell helps us to understand, when the Illuminati get caught, they usually just queue up Plan B and go right for Plan B. All right, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Next one up. Sputnik International, the one who reported a couple of days earlier, telling everybody it's the most horrible, worst strain ever in the entire universe. Well, they come back out and they say, oopsie, except they didn't say oopsie. They just said the new strain was originally registered in South Africa, and they come out and they say, it's not anything to be worried about. It's just unbelievable. So now it's too late, though. Fire called in the theater. Everybody's running for their lives. All the airports are shut down. They're buckling up everybody. The whole state of New York is on like red alert, lockdown alert everywhere. I mean, it's just out of look at what's happening. We're not getting any respite here. All right, next one up. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. All right, Australia records more deaths following COVID vaccines than all other shots combined over the last 50 years. All I have to say is,
you're good. Thanks, Captain Obvious. I was on a totally different track.
You know, these governments that are waking up to the attack on humanity that has been taking place now for almost 2 years, it's like, it's about time. What's the matter with you people? But anyway, then they're surrounded by all these entities, these tares, these things that, you know, people make the mistake of thinking that tares are unbelievers in the Bible. The wheat and the tares? No, they're not. They're not. They look like humans, but they're not human. That's what that's all about. We're surrounded by those things. All right, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Next one up. The Jerusalem Post. Iranian arrested in Kenya for planning a terrorist attack against Israeli target. I know, folks. Get ready. The whole pandemic attack thing, all that kind of stuff. I almost hate to have to announce, you know, to report the news on that stuff, because what's happening is it's a sleight of hand. Everybody's so concerned and running for their lives. Oh, no. Oh, no. It's another one. Oh, my gosh. Here comes the Omicron. Run for your lives. Oh, my goodness. We're missing everything else. It's setting up the world for the Gog and Magog War, World War III, the global financial collapse, and the Black Swan event that could happen at any time, because we're all so busy worrying about that which we have the power in the name of the Lord Jesus to come against. Oh, well. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Next one up. Jerusalem Post reports that Israeli military readying for Plan B if Iran nuclear talks fail. Gee, I wonder what Plan B could be. Kids, do you wonder what Plan B could be? No, I know you're not wondering. You know what Plan B is. All right, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. We played it 1,000 times on the radio. Well, I don't know if it was 1,000. Could have been like, I don't know, 768. I have no idea how many times, just bunches of times. All right, next one up. Hallelujah. Whitmer, the governor of Michigan, that we all love so dearly, loses control of the virus in the state of Michigan again. The United States military is stepping in as the situation grows dire. People are, you know, there's rebellions in the streets and everything else. And there's poor people in Michigan. Oh, man. In California, Michigan, California. Oh, my gosh. Oh, well, next one up. Thank you, Jesus. Here we go. Island of rhesus monkeys in South Carolina exposed to the NIAID's source for excruciating experiments. This, by the way, is the entity Fauci's organization, which is connected to the NIH directly. And I could read for you what they're doing to the puppies, but I'm not going to. Right, kids? We're not going to talk about the puppies. I can't even believe that made print. It's disgusting. All right, praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Next one up. Massive asteroid stronger than a nuclear bomb will swoosh past the Earth in late December, report says. Well, we know that there are going to be meteors, smaller ones and stuff, and we know that they're practicing right now. They're practicing to blow the things up because they know what's coming. They believe the Bible more than most Christians. They know the Bible. Our enemy knows the Bible better than, not, I mean, like many times a magnitude better than most of the preachers and the teachers that are available out in the world today. They do. Anyway, praise God. Next thing up, Australia declares war on trolls. And so basically what they've done is they've come out with this thing. It says, if you're on the internet and you're, you know, making comments that we don't agree with, we're coming after you. Now they want. Now it's not just a matter of, you know, Twitter taking down your post or whatever the case, or, you know, YouTube taking down your post or Facebook taking your post or whatever the case. No, no. Now the government of Australia is looking at the comments, and if they don't like the comments, they're going to try. They want the name of the individual that put the comment there, and they want to come after them legally. Yeah. Isn't that just dandy? Praise God, folks. We're getting closer. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Next one up. Michelle Obama and Kamala Harris are in the lead now to run against whoever into 2024 for the Democrats, according to this report. Now, there are other people out there that are saying crazy things like it's going to be Hillary Clinton with Obama. And I'm like, no, I don't think so. But who knows? I just don't know if we're even going to make it that far. Next one up. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Thousands flood the streets to decry vaccine mandates. This is happening all over Europe, but it's not quite as widespread as it just seems like it's really widespread, but it's only about maybe six or seven major cities, but nevertheless, but there's hundreds of cities in Europe. So there really needs to be even a bigger outcry. Futurism magazine reports San Francisco is sinking into the earth, according to scientists, which it is. Another headline from the Daily Mail, NASA's first ever planetary defense mission is ready for launch this week to test if an asteroid can be deflected by crashing a spacecraft in it at 15,000 miles per hour. What do you suppose they're doing that for? Could it be that they know what's in the Bible and they want to prepare for it? Could it be that they know what's coming? Do you think Satan knows what's coming? I think he does. Now, what he doesn't know is what our Father's going to do, and what he doesn't know is when our Father's going to respond to the prayers of the saints. And when he that restrains is taken out of the way, I'm not going to say it. Praise God. Let's just say that there was a thing that was said an awful lot on the TV series known as the A-Team. I pity the... You know what I'm saying? All right, praise God. And it was Jesus that used the term in the parable, and I'm not going there. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. And on that note, let's go ahead and bring on Sister Trupti Desai. Thank you, Jesus. Here we go. Okay, sister, I need you to help me out. I don't know if it's Trupti or Trupti. Which one is it?
Trupti.
I hit it. Yay! Yeah. I get a gold star. Hi. Thank you, Jesus.
Hi.
Hey, you know, it's better than my last name. Johnny Baptist is my radio show name, but my last name is like, okay, let me spell it for you. S as in Sam, E as in elephant, you know, and I got to do that like I don't know how many times a day. Every time I call CVS, it's like, you know, oh my gosh. But anyway, thank you for joining us. On that note, praise God, I'm going to turn the mic over to you. I'm not going anywhere. I'll just be quiet with my little virtual folding chair in the back of the virtual Ecclesia stage, and you're going to take the podium and just share with us whatever the Lord has placed on your heart to share with us. Amen?
Amen.
It's all yours. God bless you. Thank you.
Thank you. You too. So what I'm going to talk about, I believe, is really, really relevant for this hour, and there's three major visions of off today. First, I've been given three visions related to George Washington's third vision. He got three visions as well, and a Red Sea vision, and then a word about the black horse for this time. So I'll go ahead and start with the George Washington visions. So why this really lays heavy on my heart is we're in a time of revolution. We're literally in a revolutionary war right now. And George Washington had a deep devotion to God. He had a deep devotion to honor and love of freedom and justice. And, you know, Thomas Jefferson as well said, God gave us life. God who gave us life, and he gives us liberty too. So we mustn't forget that. I don't think a lot of people know, but George Washington, on December the 19th, 1777, had a visitation from an angel and got three visions. Spiritual experiences tend to be ignored by secular historians, so I don't believe that these three visions are well known. The first vision related to the War of Independence, the Revolutionary War. The second vision related to the Civil War. Now we're in the third vision, and it's related to now. So what I'd like to do is to actually read this vision and then read the continuation, what the Lord has given me. What is remarkable, though, is the first vision I was given was on December 19th, 2020, literally the same day, 243 years later, a vision related to George Washington's third vision. So I looked up the meaning of 243 in my handy biblical numbers book, and it means things exalted. So this Revolutionary War calls for the saints, the remnant, to stand up. And that's the marker, 243 years later. So now go ahead and read George Washington's third and most fearful peril. So this is what we're under right now, and it surely is fearful. Then my eyes this is George Washington's vision, to be clear. Then my eyes beheld a fearful scene from each of these continents. And the continents of Europe, Asia, Africa, arose thick black clouds that were soon joined into one. And throughout this mass, there gleamed a dark red light by which I saw hordes of men. This dark red light is the color and the symbolism of communism. Nations on every continent under the political forces of communism are now currently hostile to the United States. And so it is at this point of time. These men moving with the cloud to cloud of communism marched by land and sailed by sea to America, which country was enveloped in the volume of cloud. And I dimly saw these vast armies devastate the whole country and the villages, towns, and cities which I had seen springing up. As my ears listened to the thundering of the cannon, the clashing of the swords, and the shouts and cries of millions in mortal combat, I again heard the mysterious voice saying, "Son of the Republic, look and learn." Where the voice had ceased, the dark shadowy angel placed his trumpet once more to his mouth and blew a long and fearful blast. Now make no mistake, the Lord is in control of everything that's going on. He knows what he sees everything. Unfortunately, we're in charge, but he's in control ultimately. So heaven intervened. Simply a light as of a thousand suns shone down from above me and pierced and broke into fragments the dark cloud which enveloped America. At the same moment, the angel upon whose head still shone the word Union and who bore our national flag in one hand and a sword in the other, descended from the heavens, attended by legions of white spirits. These immediately joined the inhabitants of America, who I perceived were well nigh overcome, but who immediately, taking courage again, closed up their broken ranks and renewed the battle. Again, amid the fearful noise of the conflict, I heard the mysterious voice saying, "Son of the Republic, look and learn." As the voice ceased, the shadowy angel for the last time dipped water from the ocean and sprinkled it upon America, and instantly the dark cloud rolled back together with the armies it had brought, leaving the inhabitants of the land victorious. Then once more I beheld the villages, towns, and cities springing up where I had seen them before, while the bright angel planting the azure standard, which I believe is the presidential seal, he had bought in the midst of them, cried with a loud voice, "While the stars remain and the heavens send down dew upon the earth, so long shall the Union last." and taking from his brow the crown on which blazons the word union, he placed it upon the standard, while the people kneeling down said, Amen. So that's his third vision, and that's what we're in right now. And so I believe the Lord has now given me a continuation of that third vision and has shown me what is actually happening now in the destiny of what's going to happen and you know, that we're facing in the nation, you know, as we speak. Yet the Lord had given the, you know, George Washington, who was an amazing man of God, exactly, he gave him the blueprint of what we're undergoing right now. So that is, again, in itself is remarkable. And again, as I said, on the exact day, December 19th, 2020, 243 years later, you know, little me gets a vision, the first vision from the Lord. So I'll go ahead and speak about the vision then. So the vision that I got started with an empty Oval Office. The Oval Office was covered in white light. I saw Melania dressed in white and blended in the background of white snow. I then see President Trump and Melania in a chariot being chased in the dark by many black wolves. They look behind, and Melania is frightened, but not President Trump. I then see two beautiful horses, white as snow, and Jesus is commandeering the chariot. He is standing on the horse's back with one foot on each horse, and he has a large golden whip. The chariot goes faster and faster, and the wolves get left behind. The chariot rises into the sky, and I see President Trump and Melania at the foot of the throne of God kneeling. Melania is still in pure white, and President Trump gets a new anointing and a new identity. It's David John Trump. I hear this three times, and he is given a purple robe. Now, this is the part where I see President Trump dressed like George Washington. In the same vision, I see President Trump dressed like a general to George Washington. It's just that type of garb. He's dressed like a general in 1776, trudging through the white snow. He stops and looks up, and hundreds of silver swords fall from the sky. So, if you recall, there were thousands of white spirits that fell from the sky in George Washington's vision. Not one of them touches him. He is now surrounded by swords. He commands the troops to charge. Angels descend and begin to destroy demons and missiles, and a mighty battle ensues. During the battle, I see a dome-shaped covering that appears to protect them, and I see him conversing with Jesus and taking his instructions from him. I then see Jesus at the top of the snow mountain on a white horse. He views the battle below. There is a lot of bloodshed. And the next thing I see is that the wolves are being put in a large black net. Taken in the net are still alive, and they try to escape the net. A multitude of angels carry this net into the sky, which has hundreds of wolves, and throws them into a fiery pit. The vision ends, and I am left with a strong fear of the Lord. So this was the first vision, and I see how the Lord is connecting President Trump somehow to George Washington. So I shared this. Somebody shared this with a lady who has been studying George Washington visions for the most of, 20 years now. And so this was her interpretation. She said, I'm skipping down to the part President Trump dressed as a general in 1776. Well, the first thing that came to mind were the three angelic visions that George Washington received. It has been agreed among many that the third vision is what is before us now. As you read the vision, make note of the turning point. The turning point is where heaven intervened. There is suddenly a powerful light as well as a sword and legions of white spirits. I believe the vision specifically where he says he stops and looks up and hundreds of silver swords fall from the sky. Not one of them touches him. He is now surrounded by swords and he commands the troops to charge. Angels descend and begin to destroy demons and missiles and a mighty battle ensues. And she's the one that told me. She said, I believe that about the date. I believe these may be the same moment in time and space. What George Washington saw with all those legions of light and coming down, I saw the swords and they were like, you know, silver swords and, you know, hundreds and hundreds of them. So the Lord showed me that in the same moment of time and space, and why? Because it was on the exact date, except, you know, many years later. So that's the first vision. And so why I feel this is so important is because, just like it said in George Washington's vision, right, that America will prevail. He says very specifically, he says that while the stars remain and the heavens send you down upon the earth, so long shall the Union last. So President Trump has some kind of role. I know currently that he's not in the position that he should be, but he has a role, and we'll come to see what happens. But the Lord has put him into a very specific part. Now, the Revolutionary War, if I'm interpreting this correctly, you know, started December 19th, 2020. It's like we're literally in that Revolutionary War, just like George Washington was at that time. And we've been fighting. You know, you mentioned parents standing up, you know, even Democrats joining the Republicans, us becoming one. It is. And the saints being exalted. So, again, the marker date or marker year of 43. It's a time of war. And it doesn't – I know there aren't missiles right now exactly, and we shall to see, of course. But, you know, we're in a cyber war, we're in a war of words, we are in a sense in a war, and definitely just like Facebook and other entities, you know, are stopping the words and the truth from coming out. So it's a war against truth, obviously, as well. So it might not be, you know, your typical war of cannons and guns exactly, but indeed we are in war. And the next vision will explain that a little more thoroughly. And so as we stand up, as the saints are exalted, you know, as the remnant holds the line, which is another word that I'll share a little later, the Lord will turn things around. And, you know, we must have faith. We can never give up. We can never say, oh, well, not, you know, it won't happen. Yeah, the time is dark, but the Lord will do what the Lord will do. And I trust what he says. So if he says we will stand as a country, we will stand. Here's another word from the lady who studied George Washington's visions for 10 years. She said just recently the Lord showed her how the angel called President Washington the son of the Republic. But the revelation she got was Washington was not a son. He was the father. Trump is the son that lives out the vision George Washington saw. So here we are, and the Lord is just showing me being lived out to say. So Jesus took the reins fully in that vision. He was in charge. He was in control of the chariot as those wolves. And the wolves, of course, are, you know, the Democrats and all these wicked people, you know, communists and whomever else from many countries, many continents. I mean, the war came from many sides. The wolves came from many sides of the world, right? So as they were chasing, which was absolutely the case, Jesus took the reins fully come that date, December the 19th, 2020. And he is with us. Sometimes it's scary. I get it. The Lord is with us. So she also feels that the fear of God will start to become more prevalent in this age. So, you know, it's very exciting and interesting, of course. So moving forward now, you know, I get that vision. And then on January the 8th, 2021, at 10:49 a.m., I get another vision, and I want to call it the vision of war. So that morning, I woke up, something big happening in the spiritual realm, and I'm very sensitive to the spirit, so I just sense and feel things as well. And my spirit was very agitated and excited. I just couldn't sit down. It was like a lot of things happening. So I woke up in the morning hearing the word war, war, war. So as I paced back and forth, I received a word at 10:49 as well that morning, which I'll read to you shortly. And then I got another revelation / vision at 12:45 p.m. that day. At 12:45 p.m., I looked outside my office window, and I first saw the swords. I saw the swords again falling on the sky, and then I saw the angels with the swords. See President Trump walking in the snow, just like I had seen in the enactment of the vision of the wolves that I, you know, which was the vision, the first vision. I saw the wolves again chasing President Trump in the chariot with Melania and Jesus holding the reins of the two white horses, and they're taken to the throne of heaven. Again, I see President Trump and Melania kneeling at the throne. President Trump is given his new anointing as the King David, as King David. He has a beautiful gold crown with many jewels and a purple robe. Melania is given a purple robe as well. She is dressed in the same blue dress that she wore on Inauguration Day in January 2017. And I see President Trump being given a big golden key. It looks exactly like the key of David. Gold key that was given to me on November 15th, 2020. This time it is much bigger and brighter and in a beautiful case. President Trump sat with the Father and Jesus for quite a while, and I think that's what's happening. I mean, literally there's a reckoning with the Father, Lord Jesus, President Trump. He's, you know, we have to be prepared at the throne, and that's, I feel, it was the period that we're somewhat in. And, you know, sometimes the people he relied on maybe were not necessarily listening to the Lord. And this is his journey with the Lord. And he has to, you know, become like a very strong, godly leader for this country once the time arises again. I then see President Trump walking through the beautiful white snow again, wearing clothes like George Washington. His clothes are blue, gold, and white. He has a gold sword, and the large golden key is dangling from his waist belt, and he is walking with intention. He has golden cowboy boots engraved with some kind of design. I didn't understand why he was wearing cowboy boots, and in my spirit, I was like, is he coming to Texas? Is he going to be in Texas? Now, mind you, I got this vision on January 8th. And because it was snowing and he was walking through the snow, January the 10th. Yeah. I was at church and it started to snow here in Texas. And I saw it as a sign. I was like, oh my goodness, President Trump's coming to Texas. His boots are going to come right here on this land. And unbelievably, I think it was on the 13th or the 12th, he landed right there by the Alamo. And he gave us by the Alamo wall. It was right there. So the Lord had showed me how he was going to come put his feet on Texas. So there's something very significant about Texas and him, you know, as a king, I suppose, you know, putting his feet here. It was something significant that I'm yet to understand, but it happened. He then stops and places his gold sword in the snow, and I hear the words, charge, charge, charge. He stands still, and the swords begin to fall like lightning all around him. President Trump is not harmed. He goes back to the dome. I hear secure military base, and he is taking his instructions yet again from Jesus. Bloodshed begins, and I now see the wolves, some of which have the heads of the following people. So I literally see these wolves' bodies, and I see the faces of the falling people, Pelosi, Biden, Schiff, Cuomo, Newsom, and Chief Roberts. So their faces are on the wolves' bodies. They and the other wolves are running scared. Arrows from the angels strike them. I see wolves killed and others are taken up in the net. One of the wolves is Bill Gates, and he is a very, very big, vicious wolf, and he battles fiercely and tries to escape. However, I see him and Soros taken up in the same net with the other wolves. I see the wolves in front of the judgment throne and getting told their fate. The two main wolves I see are Gates and Soros. I then see Archangel Michael, whom I saw during my visit to the courts of heaven on the evening of January the 6th, where hundreds of judgment scrolls with a blue and gold seal were handed out by the mighty I Am to the angels. So on January 6th, I woke up and I heard the Lord's voice since I was 4 years old. And I'm certainly, you know, many decades older than that. So I wake up to this loud booming voice, and the Lord says, choose this day whom you will serve. And I am fearful, and of course I'm going to serve my Lord, but this was a warning, you know, the wheat and the tares. The Lord has said to me, I've been separated in this hour in a mighty way. So that day was significant for many a reason. And that night I was sent to my prayer closet, and I spent many hours in the closet that night, and I was taken to the throne room, and I saw the Lord handing out these judgment scrolls, and unbelievably, they had the blue and gold seal, which, you know, is the presidential seal, and they were being handed out, and I saw Archangel Michael with a huge scroll, and on that scroll was the blue and gold seal, and these angels would be sent to the north, the south, the east, the west. They were being sent all over the world. And then the word I got 2 days later spoke about the scrolls of judgment being given. Now, they are under judgment. Now, when they get final judgment, you know, things are happening, and I'm getting different words. But there's specific people that have been, they should say that the scrolls of judgment and their names are on those scrolls of judgment, and they've been marked, okay? So Archangel Michael had a very big scroll also sealed by the hand of God. So I see, now this is the vision, right? So the January 6th was not part of the vision, but I got to see Archangel Michael in that on January the 6th. And this word was given in February. So Archangel Michael had a very big scroll, also sealed by the hand of God. I see Archangel Michael standing on the United States of America somewhere in the middle. And I want to say it's Texas, but honestly, I really didn't see it clearly. So, and while he's standing in the middle right there, a mighty battle ensues with a very large demonic principality, which I believe is Satan. I don't know. It was huge. It was gigantic, very large demonic principality. So Archangel Michael fights with this demonic spirit. The principality whimpers away, defeated, and Archangel Michael throws the principality into the Atlantic Ocean. When he gets thrown in, it's almost like he's swimming. It turns into something that can swim. It's just horrible looking. But anyway, I then see battleships in the ocean blowing up and getting destroyed. At that moment when he gets thrown in, for some reason, there's a lot of destruction of some battleships. While I'm writing this vision, I see the word war, war, war appear on both my palms. And then I see the word blessing. So, as I had mentioned, I got a word, and I got a vision on the same day, the second vision. So, at 10:49 a.m. on 1/8, the same day I got the vision, I received the following word from the Lord. Take heed, Satan. You have been put on notice by the Almighty God of the universe. You will fall with a great thunder and will not prevail. Do you hear me? You will not prevail. Stand in judgment and take great counsel in my might. You are a schemer, a liar, a deceiver. My brethren, stand strong. Stand strong, my child. The hour has come for the world to see my justice. Prevail, I say, prevail. The hour is upon us, and stand in the face of the evil. Go, child, go to the people and tell them to prepare for victory. Tell them to shout out my name. Jesus, 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 the Calvary has arrived. Go forth and tell them not to fear. My judgment will prevail, I say, from the throne of judgment. The scrolls have been sent to the wicked. So that's connected to the vision I was given. And they're going to cry. This is very interesting. And they're going to cry and run and betray each other. You will see a lot of betrayal going on among the wicked. They will take others down with them. Who knows when the hour begins? I, the Lord Almighty, who do you think you are? Watch and see. Stand in the face of evil. So the saints, the remnant, must stand. When we've done all to stand, we stand in the face of evil and see my victory. So this is the Lord's victory. And it's all glory to our Father, right? It's not our glory, is his glory, and he will decide when. So the wicked will turn upon themselves, and in a sense they will self-destruct, is what I'm understanding. And Satan doesn't know. He's trying to hurry the timeline. I don't believe he understands the times. He sees and he watches and he perceives what to do, I suppose. But the word, at least from the Lord that I've been given, is that he's hurrying the timeline, but it's just not time because we need the harvest to come through. There's a mighty, mighty harvest that still needs to, to be, to come through, right? So, I heard what you said earlier, John, too, right? With the vaccine and things like that, people may perish and stuff, and I hope that's not exactly the harvest, but obviously anyone who perishes, we pray that they are saved. But from what I understand is, the Lord is coming for a pure bride in a mighty harvest. Again, this is just what I'm hearing, is that Satan is having the timeline, and it's just not his time. And based on the George Washington visions and these words I've given, we will prevail. But it's the same, again, the number 243, the saints will be exalted. This is the time for the saints to be exalted, the saints to stand up and fight and stand and to hold the line and hold the darkness back. And it's happening. People are standing up. We are having some victories. As dire as it seems, there are victories. People are standing up. The saints are being exalted. The remnant is standing. And the prayers are reaching the heaven. So here is the third vision. Now, the third vision was on February the 2nd, 2021, at 11:27 p.m. So this is the vision of the lion's roar. So this is the final vision. This is when we'll see victory. Now, in this vision, I see President Trump dressed as George Washington once again, walking the late afternoon. And then all of a sudden, it's nighttime. I then hear that the bewitching hour is here. He is now walking toward the dark, woody area that has a lot of large trees. I sense a lot of danger and hope he is watching his back as I feel he's going to be attacked. I see footprints of blood in the snow behind him as he walks. President Trump gets behind one of the large trees, and I see his mouth turn into the mouth of a lion, and he lets out a fierce roar, and I am taken back by the power of his anger. And this is how I interpreted the third vision. Woods means beginning of freedom, but not fully secured. This connects to the 10th dream I had of President Trump when he was running through the woods with the football. The football signifies the election, claiming the promise of God. Blood in this vision means the Holy Spirit. A big tree means Jesus. Snow means robe of righteousness and glory. I believe when it becomes night time and I hear the bewitching hour, it is the time of the devil whereby witches and demons are most powerful. So in a sense, we are in the bewitching hour too, while the demons, you know, we're in a spiritual battle. Right? In Ephesians, it says we fight principalities and powers, right? And we are in an epic, epic spiritual battle. So, yes, the bewitching hour is here. The witches and the demons are, unfortunately, you know, powerful in a sense, but so are the saints. When we have God, we are more powerful. So we're fighting them. And in a sense, we're in the bewitching hour, so to speak. President Trump turns into a lion's mouth. The roar means fearless authority, making a declaration, and God's voice. So it's God's voice. God will speak through him. In summary, President Trump is walking with the Holy Spirit and is protected by Jesus and is walking in righteousness. In the second vision, where he spends a longer time at the foot of the throne, he's being prepared for the next phase to rule over the republic and getting closer to the Lord. This is what has been happening, apparently, since he left the throne. However, he never really lost it, as he is still the illegitimate king. He is in this time also given the King David anointing. So we are currently experiencing great demonic warfare right now, but the Lord through President Trump will make a fearless, fierce, powerful declaration blessed by Almighty God, and the true King will overcome the enemy. I hope this blesses and encourages you to stay the course. Almighty Adonai always has the final say. And he is encouraging us through George Washington's third vision and the three visions he gave to us to give us hope, stay in faith. And then I'm given Hebrews 11:1, which is, now faith is confidence in what we hope for and assurance about what we do not see. We have to stand in great faith and know that the Lord will deliver us from this evil. And it is something that was going to happen. It was prophesied. It was going to happen. And so when you know, even biblically, there's things happening right now that, you know, we're definitely in the end times. And so this vision falls, you know, in the end times. And we are under a great peril. But stay in faith. And know that God is in control, and He has given me many dates and many markers to show that He's in control, that He watches everything. And some things are to the exact date, which is just absolutely remarkable. And so I'm in absolute awe of my Father. So, John, it's 8 o'clock to the dot. Should I continue or...
Yes, but I'm also going to bring some clarification to the audience. She is not saying that the Bible is not going to come true. Hold on a second. All right. I've got to take control just for a second, and then we'll discuss how we go on. All right. So Trupti, I don't want to speak for you, but I will say this. The Bible's not going to, the Bible is going to come true. The things that Jesus told us about are happening right now. The Olivet Discourse is in progress, and the final harvest of the people of the world, the unbelievers, et cetera, is something that happens as the darkness rises. So it's not one or the other, but it's both of those things happening at the same time. So so again, I just want to help the audience. I want to make sure that I level set because this program focuses on the big picture. And if, you know, and what the Lord has shown you has to do with, you know, Trump returning evidently in 2024, I would assume that's what you're referring to. We already know that evangelical Christianity has been praying for over 2 years by the tens of thousands across the entire country, and the Father has not responded, not once, any of those prayers. We also know that we have dozens of leading prophetic voices in the evangelical community that have been prophesying that Trump is going to return into the White House now for 2 years, and it has not come true. All right, so let's just be, we got to be honest, you know, we don't want to be stretching the truth here. So if what you saw or, you know, saw in your visions, et cetera, comes true, then the only way that that can manifest is if Trump is, you know, if we get through all this stuff, there isn't a black swan event like we were talking about earlier, the midterms do occur, and Trump is returned back into the presidency for a time. What we want to be very, very clear to the audience about is that this does not curtail, it does not delay, it does not suggest that what Jesus said in the Olivet Discourse is not going to come to this country, because it already has. It does not mean that there isn't going to be pestilence and famine and all the other horrible things that are going to happen, because they're going to happen in this country. Okay, there are more judgments written about in the Bible on Israel and the United States of America than any of the other 243 countries in the entire world. We are one of the most judged countries by God in the entire Holy Bible. All right. So again, this is talking about the immediate future. I have, you know, for what it's worth, I'm not saying I know that God is in, you know, I'm beyond any shadow of a doubt, our Heavenly Father is in control, and He makes, you know, the good and the bad. He's, you know, Ecclesiastes 7 verse 14 is very clear that when, you know, times are prosperous and good, that we should give, you know, praise to God, but we should also be aware that when times get bad, that both come from our Father. As Jesus said, it rains on the just and the unjust. So this is talking about our imminent future. We have discussed in the past that, you know, there's a possibility that Trump may very well come back in 2024, and then, well, it is my personal belief that all hell is going to break loose across this country like we have never seen before, and it is going to get really, 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 really bad. We're going to see in the midst of that bad, as we know, because our Bible says so. Okay, and when our Bible says, when your righteous judgments are in the earth, the inhabitants of the world will learn righteousness. This is not a righteous country. Okay, you know, unfortunately, it is not. And the things that the churches are teaching are not proper doctrine. Okay, we have got, just to your point, Trupti, we are to be holy. Ephesians 5:27. Jesus is coming for a glorious church without spot or wrinkle or any such thing, and that she should be holy and with
you know, without a blemish. And that is not what we have in this country right now. We have people that are, you know, got their priorities out of order. Their first love is not Jesus. Their first love is being saved by Donald Trump. And that is not okay. All right. That is not okay. Right. Jesus is your first love. We are citizens of heaven. Okay. We are not citizens of any country. We are citizens of heaven. That's what the Bible says. All right. So, but these are important words, because if these things do come true, now we also have to keep in mind, okay, that we all prophesy in part, that our Heavenly Father is in control, that He does respond to the prayers of the saints, that there are kingdom dynamics that are happening. They happened all throughout the Old Testament. We know that God does respond to the prayers of the saints at times if it's within His will. And so anything is possible. God does call, I call it calling audibles. Okay. At any time, our Heavenly Father could make a decision, like I believe He made in 2016, because there was a lot of prophecies and dreams and visions that were indicating that Obama was going to start martial law and that there was not going to be any election in 2016. So obviously our Heavenly Father called an audible. We had Donald Trump for a time. Hopefully some of the Christians out there that have been saying the things that they have been saying that haven't come true for the last 2 years might rethink things a little bit, but so far they haven't been. Okay, so anyway, on that note, I just wanted to make sure that when you look at the biblical timeline, the biblical end times timeline, Sister, you know, I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I'm just saying, Sister Trupti, don't get the wrong impression. She's not preaching seven mountains nonsense. She's not telling everybody that Jesus is going to take over the world and the educational system. She's not telling you that the Book of Revelation needs to be redacted and ripped out of the Bible. She's not saying any of that.
No.
What she's just talking about is the focus on what could happen to this country. And by the way, just so you all know, I have other prophecies, prophetic words. One of them is the, and I'm looking on the website just to make sure I don't, give you the wrong information. But hold on just a second. Okay, critical prophecies, scrolling down, looking. I want to give you the Chuck Young brand. Okay, so Chuck Young brand, I hope to high heaven that God has changed His mind about a few of the things that Chuck Young Brandt was shown back in the 80s. But I will say this. When you read the Chuck Young Brandt vision, and you can find that at tribulation-now.org, you hover your mouse cursor over the words critical prophecies, and you scroll down. Those are the top. Those are some really Mac Daddy super deluxe amazing prophecies that will just teach a lot. Now, the Chuck Young Brandt one I struggle with because of some of the timeline elements that are in there. They don't line up with other stuff. However, Chuck did see the first attack against the United States, which we have tons of prophecies, dreams, and visions that confirm it, unless God changes His mind. That's always an option. He has that option. It's called relenting. Okay, if you use your Amplified and your New King James, or in one of maybe another dozen more other translations, the word is relent. The King James has it wrong. The King James incorrectly translates it into the word repent. God does not repent. God relents. That means He changes His mind, just like He did when Moses said, please don't destroy the Israelites because it'll make you look bad in front of Egypt, et cetera, et cetera. Okay, and when God changed His mind, He relented, not repented, relented. Okay, and if you do a study on that, you will understand that these are all dynamics. And Sister Trupti is absolutely correct. We are in, I believe right now, and I think it's going to get a lot worse, that there is a demonic spiritual war. The hordes of hell have been released upon the earth, but God is in control. So we have to remember God was the one who allowed, just to go back to Job chapter, Job and 1 verse 9, chapter 1 verse 9, Satan says to our Heavenly Father, does Job fear God for nothing? Does Job fear God for nothing? I thought you had a hedge of protection around him, around his family and his animals on every side. Satan was absolutely blown away. He could not believe that our Heavenly Father would allow him to touch Job. All right? God is in control. So when He lifts His hands of protection off of a country or off of the world or off of a nation, That's when really bad stuff happens. Until he that restrains. He that restrains is not the Holy Spirit. He that restrains is our Heavenly Father. It is heaven's resources, heaven's power, heaven's angels. It is the prayers of the saints. It is the whole deal. And we're all a part of that, and we just have to watch, pray like we were told to, and recognize that this doesn't change any of the end times timeline at all. It doesn't change anything that Jesus warned about. It doesn't change us about anything that's in the book of Revelation. It doesn't change anything. All it does is it gives us a pretty good idea of what is likely to happen in 2024, which I think is really important, really, when you consider all the other possibilities, and some of those are pretty gruesome. So anyway, I wanted to make sure that the listeners of the program didn't get confused about the, because it's easy to get confused, and it's like, you know, because I'll start getting emails and they'll all be like, well, if Trump is going to save the world, then I guess we might as well tear the book of Revelation out of the Bible. You know, there are people out there that actually believe and have been preaching that they've been having dinner with Jesus. And I can name names, by the way. They're evangelical prophetic voices that are out there, and I know who they are. And my sister loves them because she worships Donald Trump like Jesus. And that's wrong. And that's an insult to the throne room of God. And so anyway, it is. And, so it's one thing to be used by God, but it's another thing to be puffed up and have a whole bunch of people thinking that you're going to save them instead of, you know, seeking the Lord Jesus on their own. But all that being said, I just want to make sure everybody gets this. The point is, this doesn't really change anything. You know, they could try a black swan event. They could try to stop the midterm elections. It's up to God whether or not any of that is allowed. Okay. So that's what I wanted to level set, so I don't get a whole bunch of emails and people getting, you know, like, oh no, what does that mean? Are we going to be here for another 10 or 20? No, it doesn't mean any of that. As a matter of fact, just so you know, Sister Trupti, I mean, I don't want to freak you out or nothing, but I'm just going to let you know. Yeah. I've had people on this program, and when you saw the blood behind Donald Trump's shoes, I've had a number of people that are very pointed say that they saw Donald Trump going down the street in a casket, that he was shot and killed. Okay, so, we're going to have to wait. We're going to have to wait and see how that all happens. But the moment that you mentioned the blood behind him, I thought that came to my mind. And that, by the way, would also kick off the civil war that was seen by David Wilkerson and the civil war that was seen by Dmitry Dudeman back in 1983 in his book Through the Fire Without Burning, and some other people as well. So anyway, I just wanted to go ahead and share that. We do have another 15 minutes or 16, 17 minutes or so before the half hour mark, which is where we run out of time. If you want to share some more, you're welcome to.
Thank you. And may I also level set? Listen, I don't know the exact timing, and Jesus does come first. What I do believe, though, is the Lord will use people as instruments, right, to do certain things on earth, like he did, you know, he used Moses, he used Abraham, King David, whomever, right? So we mustn't worship the person. What we're vessels for his use. That sounds for his purpose. Let's put it that way, right?
Absolutely.
And so I see Donald Trump more as a vessel that can bring about certain things as the Lord deems so, right? And so what I just shared could potentially happen, but again, the Lord has the final say in everything. Everything. He decides. And so we'll see what comes to pass. But it was so in-depth, and there was so much information that I felt like I should share it. But again, let's see what comes to pass, okay? So I just want to make sure that you understand I agree with you, and Jesus comes first.
Okay. Oh, amen. And I knew that, but I also know, the only reason I had to make sure I cleared the understanding is that this program focuses 98 its time on the big picture, not the next 2 years, the next, and we're focusing on all the way through the book of Revelation, all the way through the Olivet Discourse. I mean, all you got to do is look at the Olivet Discourse, and every single thing that's in the Olivet Discourse is happening right now. Everything.
Okay, so we're deep in the Olivet discourse at this point. And, you know, pretty soon, if things continue as they are, which I believe that they will, the thing is, once you pull the situation, we don't have real money in this country. It's already game over. That's the thing. Donald mm-hmm. Trump can be anointed by God three ways to Sunday, but it's not going to stop the fact that we're $50 trillion in debt as a country. We're not recovering from that. There is nothing that Donald Trump can possibly do that is going to stop the third seal from occurring and the global financial collapse from occurring. So, you know, but it could definitely delay some of the horrible things that they're planning to bring upon the country and the believers for a time. And that is very, very important for us to be aware of. Praise God.
Praise God. You know, what I'm going to read, maybe this will be more relevant to what you're saying. So I'm on October the 21st this year, 2021, the Lord gave me this word, wheels of justice, judgment, and the black horse. So I believe, and, you know, please, you know, I love your feedback, but I believe it's related to Revelation. So Revelation 6:5 specifically, when he opened the third seal, I heard the third living creature say, come. And I looked and behold a black horse. And its rider had a pair of scales in his hand, and I heard what seemed to be the voice in the midst of the four living creatures saying, a quart of wheat for a denarius, and three quarts of barley for a denarius, and do not harm the oil and wine. So I believe that the black horse has to do with money and central banking, okay, and judgment, as well as famine and death, and the black horse does have scales as well. So another friend of mine had a dream the night of October 21st, the same night I got this word about the black horse. And she saw this fiery black horse in a graveyard. And there was a carriage with glass windows that carried glass coffins with a skeleton riding the black horse, which had the reflection of moonlight on its body. It was heading out of the big iron gates of the graveyard to pick up more people. So I believe it's associated to the word below. I am also a firm belief that this is a warning word, and it is associated to the Passover word. I got a word during Passover that is very important. We anoint our doors with oil during this dark time, just like what happened in the days of Egypt. So anointing our doors is important. So here's the word. Wheels of justice, judgment, and the black horse. Beloved, arise. It is time to stay the course. A mighty turnaround. Stay the course. Hold the line. Hold the line, I say. Hold the darkness back. Back, back, back will the darkness go as the dawn of a light appears on the horizon of destiny. Stand strong, brethren. Stand, for the hour has come forth like a tsunami of fiery justice. Fall, Babylon, fall. Fall has arrived, and the world will see thunderous events. Buildings will collapse under the fiery pressure of justice. People will fall into the abyss of desolation. Run, scatter to the north, south, east, and west. Nowhere to hide, nowhere to turn. You thought your ways were invincible. You thought your ways were forever. Ha, says the Lord, I have seen you and laughed in your face. Stand down, wicked of the wicked, minions of the evil ones. Stand down and receive the mighty judgment and wrath of the Lord. You will not escape this time. You will be cornered at every turn. The wicked towers you have built will fall into the abyss with you. Blessed scared, still not wanting to repent. What to do? You cannot see the blindness of your ways. The black horse has left the stable. See the death of many. Free will, free will, free will. Did I not say choose life, and you chose death? My heart cried out for many. I grieve for the ones not saved. They will perish to no avail. Pray, my saints, for great deliverance, as redemption is always near. Pray, my beloved, for those who chose the shot. I call forth the perpetrators of this evil. Their days are numbered. Fauci to fall. His judgment so severe as he orchestrated a mighty evil. He follows his master. His master will not save him. Fall into the abyss of desolation, says the Lord of hosts. Captured and tortured are their souls to be sent to the fiery pit. They will cry and I will not hear. Their evil ways are judged forevermore. Stand strong, brethren, hold the line. My mighty judgment is turning the wheels of justice. Convergence of many events will culminate into an epic day of deliverance and joy. Watch and see, this is the Lord of hosts, your Father who art in heaven. So what this means to me is there's going to be a lot of wrath and judgment and death. There's going to be something that happens with the central banks. It sounds like if the black horse, according to this word now, has been released, we've got to watch. Like you're talking about the black swan event, it could be related to that. Now, I could be hearing words some of these will happen now, and some things like the deliverance and joy, I don't know when that will happen, John. But eventually the Lord is saying there will be a lot of wrath and judgment on the wicked. Yes, I know the rain falls on us as well, but that doesn't mean the Lord's not going to judge the wicked and that his wrath will not be on them as well. And maybe more so, I don't know, but that's what I'm hearing from these words the Lord is giving.
Right. So the challenge, this mm-hmm. is something that I deal with a lot, and it's tricky because it's not.
Yeah.
We want to believe as human beings, even if we're very, very spiritual human beings, we want to believe because our DNA is wired that way. God made us that way. We want to believe that the light is either on or off. Okay? We want to believe that we are either saved or we're not saved. But that's not how the kingdom works. The kingdom works with, it has rewards, our behaviors, our works. Not everybody's going to be part of the bride. Not everyone's going to be part of the ruling class. A lot of people will make it to heaven, but they won't, have done enough for the Lord. It's all over the Bible. It's all over. Jesus tells about it right in the same parable as the wise and foolish virgins. He, without even taking a breath, he goes right into the parable of the talents and rewards. Behold, I come quickly, and my rewards are with me to give to each according to their work. All right, hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. So sitting around on our hands is not Christianly at all. Okay, now I'm not talking mm-hmm. about. So we have work to do. Jesus stood in front of Peter and he said, if you love me, feed my sheep. If you love me, feed my sheep. And we're all telling it, we're like, oh, Lord, I love you. You're my first love. Well, are you feeding the sheep? What are you doing? So, again, we're all in this together. And I hope secretly deep down inside there's a part of me that hopes. I mean, I want to go home and I wish just a bunch of meteors would fly out of the out of space and just rain down on the earth and put the, because it's going to, but on the other hand, I also want to do everything I can for the Lord. And if the Lord wants me to stay, there isn't one person that's been taken to heaven that Jesus didn't ask to come back, that he didn't ask to come back. And the person said, no, I don't want to come back. When Jesus asks us to do something for him, we want to do it for him. And by virtue of us being here, even today, this far along in the end times timeline, which is pretty far, folks, there is no greater compliment in all the universes, in all of God's kingdom, which is all the universes, there is no greater compliment than that. For God hath chosen you, and I point to Psalm 139, verse 16, and also Ephesians 2:10, for God to have chosen you for the days we are in right now. Now, I know it's hard as heck to look at all those things and say, are you kidding me? It's hard, but we have to dwell. We have to keep our minds stayed on things above and not on things of this world. We got to spend a lot of time in the secret place of the Most High, or else you're not going to qualify for the promises in Psalm 91. We got to be in prayer. We got to be reading our Bible. We got to be seeking God. We got to be praying through. We've got to understand that we have power in the name of the Lord Jesus. We can't be sitting around and running to and fro and, oh, I'm afraid of this and I'm afraid of that. We got a lot of work to do, because the darkness is going to rise and God is going to call us to the streets. And guess who's going to be healing the people that are laying in the streets dead and have arms missing because of the war situations that are going to be happening? It's going to be us. We're going to be the ones walking through the streets. We're going to be the ones raising people from the dead. And God needs us. That's why it says in Isaiah 43:25, it says, this is our Heavenly Father speaking, I am he who blots out your transgressions for my own sake, and I will not remember your sins. Keep me in remembrance. Let us contend together. Let us work together. Okay, we're here for a reason. And then believe me, nobody feels your pain more than I do. Okay? I want to go home like 10 years ago. Okay, but we're still here. So this may be a blessing in disguise for all of us to really get to where we need to be for when the days get really tough, you know, because when, you know, when the Civil War starts to happen, when the global financial collapse happens, the third seal, you know,
yeah.
It's pretty indicative. The, you know, when it says don't harm the oil or the wine, well, that's obviously the bride. So the bride is still going to be here by that time. Okay, the oil is the oil and the lamps of the wise virgins, and the wine is the new wineskins. So we know what that is. We're probably going to be here for that period. You know, and folks, what a wonderful blessing. You know, if we get a little bit of respite from this craziness that's going on right now, and we can spend a little bit more time pure in praying prayers of purification, asking our Father to show us how we need to change, to be walking in His will, to hear His voice better. You know, all the things that we can do right now, we need to be doing it, because we don't know when we're going to run out of time, but we might have a little bit more if, you know, Trump does get reelected back in 2024, which was my original prediction, because I cannot think of anything that would throw this country into civil war faster than if Donald Trump got elected and then got taken out. If that happens, this country will go immediately into civil war. Wilkerson's visions will come true. Dmitry Dudeman's vision will come true. And that's going to be, well, guess where we're going to be? We're going to be on our knees praying, because the weapons of our warfare are not carnal. They are mighty in God. Yeah. They are spiritual, for pulling down strongholds and every high thing, which is referring to principalities, powers, spiritual hosts of wickedness, and rulers of darkness in high places. Okay, that's what we do. We get on our knees, because that's where the real power of God is unleashed on this world. And it's the rest, you know, God bless the rest of them that don't understand these things, but we need to be praying for them. That is where the real power of the throne room of God is unleashed upon the world, and the devil is defeated as much as we can. But, you know, we got to be ready for that, and this could be a mighty blessing in disguise. At whatever time, extra time that God gives us to bring in more people, to awaken more people, to teach more people, to help more people receive the baptism of the Holy Spirit. These are important things in this war, this spiritual war, that we are going to be playing a very important part in the not too – well, we should be playing a major part in it right now, quite frankly.
Right now.
Amen. Now's the time. Now's the time to grab the sword of the Spirit and go into the enemy's encampment and take out those principalities and powers. We don't fight against flesh and blood. We fight against principalities and powers, and that's what we ought to be doing in our prayers. Praise God. So anyway, I wanted to go ahead and turn it back over to you if you wanted to go ahead, if you felt led to close with a prayer for us tonight.
Absolutely. May I just say that, you know, even in the Bible, there were times people went through very, very dark periods. And I love the word you said about the Lord relents. And so, you know, Father, Lord, I pray for our nation. I pray, Father, that you will show us mercy in this hour, and that many, many, many more people will be saved before the final hour, Father, Lord. Father, let us walk and speak in truth and continue to fight for freedom and justice, and for us to just stand up in the face of evil. Father, Lord, this is not a time for people to lay down their weapons of warfare. This is the time for us to pick up our weapons of warfare, Father, Lord, and to fight the darkness. And Father, Lord, you said that you will prevail. The gates of hell will not prevail, Father, Lord. And so you are in control. So Father, show your people mercy. Show us your mercy in this hour, Father, so that we can go through this time with hope and encouragement, because it is to be so that we are now in this hour, and we cannot change anything, but we can, Father, Lord, we can, through our prayers, ask you to relent and to show mercy. And so, Father, in Jesus' mighty name, I thank you. May all glory go to you. And I love you, Father, Lord. We thank you in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.
Amen. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Powerful program. And you know what? I've been telling people I predicted, almost, golly gee, about 8-9 months ago. I don't remember when, but my prediction was, and I even challenged some of the listeners. I asked you, I said, please send me an email if you can think of another reason that would jettison the United States of America into a full-blown true civil war, not some mamby-pamby bunch of people doing burning down cars and stuff in the streets of Kenosha. I'm talking about full-blown civil war, which we know is going to happen. We've got the confirmations from multiple highly trustworthy confirmed prophets over 60 years of time sprinkled about, and we know it's coming. We know it's coming. We know that the documentary, The Social Dilemma, and the artificial intelligence programming that was put into all the social media platforms like Twitter, Facebook, YouTube, is going, the experts that actually programmed it, and it's in the documentary Social Dilemma on Netflix, I highly recommend that you watch it, is designed to create civil war. We know that NBC is running a special right now about civil war in the United States of America. That isn't predictive programming, folks. It's because they know it's coming. They're orchestrating it. Okay? So, but here is an opportunity. The opportunity is that we have some time. Or at least, providing that our, things don't change or God doesn't change his mind again or whatever the case is. We don't know. But let's just assuming that the prediction that I made a while back and what was shown to Sister Trupti is accurate and remains accurate, and God doesn't, adjust the plan, okay, then that's a blessing for us. That's a blessing because I think we all need more time to draw in closer to the Lord and to get ourselves just exactly. There's too many believers out there that claim that Jesus is their Lord, but they do not understand the power that we were given in his name. And we need more brothers and sisters to understand that it is our hand that touch other people who are sick, that through the power of the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, their arms are going to be grown out. Their legs are going to be grown out. Their dead children are going to be raised from the dead. It is going to be our hands as Jesus on this earth that is going to cause those things to happen. And we have got to get more people awakened to the power of the Holy Spirit and to live it, to walk it, to believe it, and to stop running from every scary thing they see, because that is not what God would have of his people. He wants us to stand. He wants us to sing. He wants us to bring down the walls of Jericho. And we can't be doing that if we're running scared. All right. Amen. Praise God. So this is an opportunity for us all. And for me too, I'm raising my hand. I think all of us want to be as close and empowered by the presence and the anointing of the Holy Spirit and the throne room of God for the days ahead as we possibly can be. Praise Jesus. So thank you so much, Sister Trupti, for sharing this with you. You basically confirmed what I already kind of suspected. If the Archangel Michael, stopped in my bedroom tonight and said, hey, man, do you want to come home to heaven? I'd be like, is this a trick question? Is this a trick question? I don't think I'd be hesitating. Okay, but on the other hand, if Jesus showed up and said, hey, I need you to hang out for a while, I'm not going to be like, oh, come on, Lord, really? Anyway, thank you so much for joining us tonight. God bless you.
Thank you for inviting me. God bless you, too.
Awesome. Praise Jesus. Thank you all for joining us. I'm looking at the clock. It is Sunday, November the 28th. It is the end of the holiday period for Thanksgiving. I pray that you all had a blessed and peaceful time in the presence of the Lord and with your families because, well, the way things are looking right now, I don't even know if I'm going to make it up to Pennsylvania for Christmas at this point so that I can hear the Chinese people singing far, rah, 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 which is fine. Going to seeing your family at a Chinese restaurant is kind of weird, you have to admit. But anyway, praise God. Thank you all for joining us. We'll see you Wednesday night at 7 p.m., Lord willing. And pray for one another, folks. Pray for one another as much as you can. We all need as much prayer as we can get. God bless you all. Thank you for joining us tonight.